What makes Compass different to other companies who claim to be able to do the same thing?
I think, as I mentioned before, that the fact that we operate a team of clinicians as well as legal experts, if you like, and qualified lawyers, we bring together the best qualities of those two areas. So it's not the case that we're simply a law firm that, whilst undertaking a number of different areas of law, also occasionally deals with these sorts of matters. We specialise exclusively in continuing healthcare funding and nothing else. Equally, we're able to work with the pharmacists, the nurses that we employ, so that they can bring their clinical expertise in having reviewed the relevant evidence and cross-refer it to our legal expertise in drafting the appropriate arguments. So hopefully our clients stand the best opportunity of receiving the funding they ought to be entitled to. Additionally as well, where we are unique as a company is that we offer exclusively fixed fee scenarios for all of the work that we undertake. So from the very outset, there is absolute cost certainty as to what the individual would have to pay for us to undertake the work that we do. Quite often with lawyers, it's very often a situation where you pay an hourly rate and the lawyer advises you at the outset what they estimate the time will be to undertake the case. Now, the danger of that, of course, is that if it's more complex than the lawyer initially anticipated, the cost can quickly spiral and there can be no real cost certainty from the beginning. By offering fixed fees, if the case takes longer than we anticipated, that isn't a problem from the client's perspective because they will only receive that fixed cost. Some companies as well, who are not lawyers, have in the past offered no-win, no-fee arrangements to individuals, which on paper sounds like a very good scenario. You pay nothing unless you're successful. The downside of that is, of course, that the company offering that fee arrangement has to ensure that they are paid and that when they do win, the costs cover their losses for when they have not. Equally, they can in fact cherry-pick the cases to ensure that cases that perhaps we could have won but were a bit more balanced in terms of prospects they're rejecting, and they're only taking on the cases where there's absolute certainty they're going to recover their costs. Now, no-win, no-fee arrangements, generally speaking, make a charge on what the annual cost the individual would be as a reflection of their fees. So if someone is paying £50,000 a year for care costs, under a no-win, no-fee arrangement, if you succeed, you then have to pay them anywhere between 30 and 40% of those annual costs plus VAT as their fee for having won. Now, quite often, those costs can be 10 times what we would charge on a fixed fee basis. So all I would say in that regard is the reality of the situation often is it sounds too good to be true. Unfortunately, there's a reason behind that.
After the assessment's done, what can I do if I don't agree with the outcome?
Well, there's a number of options. There is an appeals process that's available, and ultimately that can result in a panel with an independent chairperson and parties independent to the original assessment process being convened. Now, the family or the representative of the family will have an opportunity to present to the panel as to why they feel the individual has been incorrectly scored and why they have been incorrectly determined not to be entitled to the funding. They can also raise any procedural issues that they feel have occurred and how the national framework has been incorrectly provided. Now, the benefit of going through this process, if it's indeed necessary, is that because the panel is independent of the particular NHS trust involved, they have the authority to overrule the original decision and can award the funding where it perhaps was incorrectly denied. Equally, because they are independent, they are not incentivised by a negative decision, which of course may well be the case with a particular NHS trust who has particular budgetary constraints. We're aware from Freedom of Information Act requests made across England and Wales that there is somewhat of a postcode lottery. Depending on what area you live in, you may well find that the neighbouring NHS trust or a trust elsewhere in the country and provides a far higher percentage of continuing healthcare funding than in the area you're in. Now, that cannot, of course, correlate. It doesn't follow that there would be a number of people who have more health needs in that particular area. Based on statistics, it makes no logical sense. And it can therefore only, unfortunately, be that people are being perhaps perhaps incorrectly denied the funding in that area, and therefore the independent appeals process is the opportunity to put that situation right.
What issues could I have accessing continuing healthcare funding?
The problems can arise, I suppose, in the fact that, first of all, many people are not even aware that this form of funding even exists. Certainly it's not something that's actively promoted, and people more often than not stumble across it when, for the first time, they've ever had to deal with any issues to do with paying for care or funding care. Even then, there is, unfortunately, lots of situations where the misinformation, incorrect information can be provided. So people who perhaps ought to be entitled to the funding are either put off from even applying in the first place, having been informed incorrectly that their relative won't satisfy the criteria, or where they have applied for the funding and the individual's needs have been incorrectly scored and underscored, and the determination has been that they're not eligible when in fact they should have been.
What is the process for securing funding?
The process is one of a number of assessments that take place. It's a two-stage, two-assessment process, the first of which is known as a continuing healthcare funding checklist. Now, that can be conducted by a number of different people, but ordinarily you would expect it to be either a qualified nurse on the ward if the person is still in hospital, or a member of the discharge team, or if the person is in a nursing home, sometimes it can be the RGN that's registered at the home. Other times it can be conducted in the community by a social worker. Now, the checklist works through 12 domains or areas of need, which looks at the different areas of the individual's health. It covers everything from their behaviour, their cognition, their affect their mental state, their ability to determine risk, etc., their communication, right through to areas including nutrition, mobility, and even areas such as their needs in relation to what's referred to as altered states of consciousness. So, for example, if somebody is having regular fits or has a history of suffering from strokes or TIAs, mini strokes. So there's 12 domains in total, and the checklist will score each issue that they have on the basis of either an A scoring, a B scoring, or a C scoring. A being the most severe, C being the least. If the individual scores two or more A's, or a combination of one A and four B's, or finally five B's, then they're deemed sufficiently serious in terms of their health needs to justify going to a full assessment, and that is the secondary assessment, which is known as a decision support tool. Now, the difference with the decision support tool assessment to the checklist is that rather than it being conducted by one individual, one assessor, it must be undertaken by a multidisciplinary team of clinicians. So what you would, the national framework for continuing healthcare funding is what underpins the whole process and effectively the rules and regulations as to how the process should be conducted and in what manner. Now, the national framework makes it very clear that a representative from the local authority, which is ordinarily a social worker, would be expected to be involved in the multidisciplinary assessment alongside a nurse. So crucially, you have somebody dealing with what they consider to be the health issues, but equally looking at it from a social care perspective as well. Rather than it being a process of scoring on A's, B's and C's, the different domains have a number of scoring titles, if you like, and they range from everything from no needs through low needs, moderate needs, high needs. And in certain domains, it goes beyond high to severe needs and even priority needs. It's looking at the same 12 domains, which in order flow from behaviour, cognition, psychological and emotional needs, communication, mobility, nutrition, then looking at continence, skin integrity. The next factor would then be discussing matters in terms of the individual's drug therapies, which also includes any pain problems that they may have, as well as the problems relating to breathing and altered states of consciousness, which, as I mentioned before, is whether they have a history of strokes or quite literally, in the most extreme form, comas or seizures. The final domain looks at any other needs, which is sort of an overriding issue of what health problems the person has. The multidisciplinary team scores the individual in each of these areas, and then, having conducted that assessment, takes a step back and says, looking at these scorings, does the person have primarily a health need on the basis that there is sufficient complexity, intensity and unpredictability in the nature of the issues that they've looked at? So the problem can be that that's quite a subjective assessment, what a particular individual on the day, particular clinician's understanding and interpretation of what the needs of the individual are. Equally, if any evidence has not been considered or an individual's needs have been incorrectly underscored in any of those domains, it can alter the final determination as to whether their needs are sufficiently complex, intense and unpredictable. And so the person could, in those circumstances, find that they have been marked down and that they're incorrectly denied the funding they ought to be entitled to.
How do I know that Compass can help me to access funding?
Personally, this is an area that I've exclusively specialised in now for a number of years. What I do is, what the company that I work for now does, is that we incorporate a specialist team consisting of trained clinicians as well as qualified lawyers. So we're bringing to the table not just our legal expertise and experience in terms of advocacy and reasoned arguments, but rather we're also able to work alongside qualified nurses and pharmacists who are able to review the relevant evidence and work alongside us to then form reasoned logical arguments as to why particular scorings should be at a particular level within the framework. We're also able to offer expert advocacy so that where it's necessary, attending assessments or indeed appeal hearings if appropriate, we're able to put forward the best arguments to ensure that the individual's needs are put forward in such a manner that no doubt can be left that they are entitled and they do meet the criteria. So equally, because of the experience that we have in this area, with the national framework, with the rules that govern this process, we're able to determine that everything is being done as it should be done, in a time frame it should be done in, so that if the individual ought to be receiving the funding, we're able to ensure that they stand the best chance of receiving it as swiftly as possible. Well, all I would say is that in the first instance, you shouldn't hesitate to contact us. We offer a no-obligation, free, confidential discussion in the first instance. We have an assessment form you can complete, giving us the information of who you are and your contact details and the issues that your relative has. We can then assess that and at a time that's convenient for you, contact you to go through matters. We're prepared to spend as much time as you require or is necessary to gather all of the information from you so that we can make a firm determination as to whether we believe there's prospects of taking the matter further forward. If there's not, we very clearly will tell you the reasons why we believe there's not at this time. We're not in the business of taking cases on that we don't believe we can achieve a successful outcome for the particular individual. That's of no benefit to anyone. And certainly we don't charge for this service in the first instance whatsoever. It's completely free, it's completely confidential. And if nothing else, if all it does is provide you the information so that you better understand the process, even if it's the case unfortunately we can't assist, we hope that you go away from that conversation with a better understanding of how the processes work. And if matters change in the future, then of course you can revert back to us and we can see whether at that point in time it's something we can assist with.
This process sounds very complicated. How can I get help with it?
I think that's quite right. I mean, as with anything, having an independent expert in your corner from the very outset is crucial to the overall success. Now, it's certainly not the case that everyone's entitled to this funding, and far from it. The bar is quite high and the individual has to have primarily health needs. However, it's often not as high as perhaps individuals are informed it is. We very regularly hear from people who've been informed that they will not be entitled to the funding because their relative is not receiving palliative care with a limited life expectancy. Now, that's completely incorrect. The national framework makes it very clear that life expectancy plays no part whatsoever in the eligibility process. And yet, if that person is then put off from even seeking an assessment, they may well have received the funding and they've been incorrectly denied it as a result. So those are the sorts of issues that can occur. I can think of no situation whereby quite literally tens of thousands of pounds annually are at stake, and over the course of somebody being in care for a number of years could amount to over £100,000 or beyond if the average cost of care is £1,000 a week for a nursing home. I can't think of any situation where, with those amounts of money at stake, that you wouldn't seek to instruct an independent expert in the particular area to advise and assist. The NHS often maintain that this is a process that the individual can undertake themselves or through the family, and they're quite correct. It's much like anything else. You can conduct the conveyancing on a property transaction yourself. You wouldn't be advised to do that, of course, because experts have their place, and I think the same process and the same principle applies to this situation.